Our next speaker is Ditte Ejlerskov. She's an artist that graduated from Malmö Art Academy in 29, and she's currently based in Skelso.
Yeah, that's
sort of.
Kind of.
Denmark, at least. And Ditte has in recent years combined her practice as a painter with explorations in AR and NFTs, among other things. And she is here to tell us more about that. Ditte, welcome.
Thank you. Wow. Seamlessly. Yes, so I will start by speaking a little bit about the crypto works that you've probably seen, those of you that are interested in NFTs, for example. So I'm just going to jump right into the very heart of the debate. These monkeys, the Bored Ape Yacht Clubs. Some of you have probably seen them. And this is what the mainstream sees when they see crypto art. And I have, of course, also big difficulties with the visual appearance of these projects, but I also see that there is a division now between the art scene of crypto and the more maybe gaming-driven economy around these artworks that are basically currency. And I think as conceptual art, I think that's actually very interesting to try to develop new ways of thinking about digital assets and money. So, but I think people get a little bit turned off when they hear crypto art because they see these images. So I will try to dive into a project where something very personal and bodily became crypto art without me planning it, really. It started with this sculpture, which is the Uffizi wrestlers, thousands of years old. And I had it printed out on my studio wall for several years, and I didn't really know what this image essentially wanted from me. But, and now I'm a little nervous, so I'm gonna fly through this next part a little fast, because speaking about giving birth to 100 people is a little intimidating. But I understood that when I was pregnant with my second child, I had to change something within myself, because my first birthing experience got very hospitalized, let's put it that way, with the interventions into my body that I was not really planning for, of course. So and my memory of it and the trauma that I had 4 years after was that I had a lot of adrenaline, and I believe that whatever energy you have in your body spreads to the room. And there were 12 people in the room when I gave birth to my son, and everyone was afraid. So I decided that I had to take control over these two hormones that are particularly present during childbirth, adrenaline and oxytocin. Oxytocin is the love hormone. For those of you that have been breastfeeding, it's the bubble of love that surrounds you, and where nobody else, nothing else matters. It's also when you hug a friend or your parents or your child, it's that feeling of connecting with another human being, and that sense of love. And if you have that in your blood during childbirth, everything runs smoothly, and breastfeeding and all the other hormones that are naturally replacing each other in a nice line, they all run perfectly. So I thought that's the way to give birth, of course. So when I got pregnant, first I was very afraid, and I was like, okay, just cut me open, take out the kid, and let me get it over with. But then I began looking at this, the wrestlers, and trying to understand what these two hormones had, what the conflict was between them. So I And so I understood the sculpture as the battle between oxytocin and adrenaline. So I began drawing and redrawing the bodies into women bodies just to be able to understand it a little better. And so I'm just going to take you through some slides of the first drawings. Some are were just on paper, and then I moved into learning new ways of drawing digitally and in a 3D model. And I wanted to make sketches for paintings. I'm a painter, and I was working with figuration, so I needed to see this body from different angles to get some good angles, some good sketches for paintings. And that's why I developed this. Then I also placed it in a environment inspired by an architect from the Renaissance called Hans Vredeman de Vries. It's this drawing. So I tried to place it in this perspective drawing and see how that worked. I was interested in different Renaissance exteriors and interiors. And that was sort of just a visual interest for me. And I began painting. And these are the two. I did so many paintings in this series, and I couldn't really get around the fact that it all looked like a Renaissance painting, and that wasn't really what I was going for. I really liked the idea of these almost sci-fi looking backlit sketches. They had so much more to offer for me. When I painted them, that something was lost, and the glossy oil painting was not really what I intended. I didn't really know what I intended, but I kept the sketches on my studio wall for a while, and I didn't show the paintings because I wasn't really finished with it. But then I began looking at them as actual potentially digital art pieces, and I've worked with video and film before, but I haven't, and audio, but I haven't really accepted my digital drawings as real art. But when I understood that when I was showing it to especially my brother, who I talk about art a lot with, and he, when I showed him the sketches in my phone, we both agreed that this backlit and the way that you show the pictures in the phone worked so much better than the final paintings. And then, of course, I understood that they needed to stay in that format, in the digital format. Then I also printed it, 3D printed it, and worked with that in different ways. And tested out printing, 2D prints, and how that worked. And then I had a big show coming up at Nikolai Kunsthal in Copenhagen, and it's a big an old church, and we had a nice talk, and she saw some sketches, Helene Nyberg, who works there, and then after a while she said, yeah, well, we have no money and we have no walls, so what are you gonna do? And because it's a church, there were no walls built. And so I was like, fuck, what am I going to do now? And then I began looking at all of my sketches again. And then I was like, okay, so this is a secret, but if there are no walls, how can I show pictures? So I wrote this carpet factory in Jylland called Wilton. They make wool carpets, basically for ships and hotels. And together with them, I developed some big woolen rocks that could hang in the room and be walls, because there were no walls in the space. Then later, she had walls built for me, so it ended up not being a necessity anymore. But just to say that when people tell me there are no walls, there are no money, it's impossible, then I actually get triggered. I don't break down. It's my personal little feminist way of working, that whenever something's not possible or is not really cooperating, that's when I begin working. So I would have never been exploring woolen rugs if I had not had this problem of being stuck with a huge show and no walls. So these sketches then became, I began taking zooms of this sculpture, so very close-ups of the upper wrestler, which I call the goddess of oxytocin. By the way, I gave birth at home in my bed with a very planned home birth. It's the most beautiful experience I've ever had. And when I got the printed out, it was with a midwife. I know this is Sweden, this is different. It was with a midwife and my boyfriend. But when I got the printed out summary of everything that had happened, all the complications were the exact same. The weight of the body of the kid was the same. The weird position, the weird things that they could track with the pulse and all of that panicked the whole room in the hospital, just didn't panic the room at home in my bedroom. So we were able to make a space where oxytocin, the hormone, the love hormone, could spread to the three people in the room and not adrenaline. I know it sounds a little you were just lucky, blah blah blah, but they were, the same problems were actually present with both births, and the experiences were so very different. Here are some process pictures from the factory of these old looms where all the wool threads were lined up in this huge space before going into the loom, and it was checked and manually guided by humans, but it was of course made by machines. Sometimes the thread would fall out and it needed to be fixed. So there are these nice little scars on the faces of some of the portraits, and I like that element of it since everything else is very computer made. When they ask me to send the picture, then when people ask you to send pictures, they always say, "Oh, it needs to be this size and then 300 dpi." Now they said, "Okay, so the picture needs to be 4x4 meters and in resolution 7 dpi, because one little pixel was one thread in the loom." I just understood that practicality of our pixel system and how that could be then one wool thread. And here is a picture from Nikolai Kunsthal with walls and paintings hanging on walls. The paintings that look very digital are manually made with a very big brushes and many, many layers of transparent paint with pigment. I thought that there are some lines going in my practice where something looks digital but is physical, and the other way around. And I painted the little sculptures as well, white, so that they look almost like porcelain. And I wanted to create this sci-fi feeling, or almost a religious sect feeling when you enter. When I worked with this sculpture in my computer, there was actually one point where I was I had it in Photoshop, and I sneezed, and I accidentally moved the two women apart from each other, and then I understood that before they were in a fight, but now they are in a hunt together. They are, both hormones are on this like quest, and I think that opens up for another field of interest for me, and another understanding of these hormones and the body and the blood and all that, just through a sneeze in a digital universe. So people sometimes say that, oh, when it becomes digital, it's so cold and there's nothing in there. But at least I found that there's a lot of communication with these programs, all the glitches when it doesn't work and all the little things that happen that you, because I'm not really good at these programs, so I just do a lot of things and test things, and then new visual expressions may occur. Here's another picture from the show. And then there is a QR code because I set free the sculpture. So the digital sculpture is a global public sculpture owned by everyone and you too. And you'll get the code in a second. When you went upstairs in this old church, I had made a film and a voiceover meditation in the ceiling with the 10 projectors. And then there were rugs on the floor as well. So you would lay there and then the audio and the visual would guide you through this understanding of how to get oxytocin, the goddess of oxytocin, to work within your own blood and how you can, I mean, if you can change around a birthing situation, then when you yell at your husband, maybe that's changeable too. So I just thought it's a good thing to learn in all aspects of life. For example, when you stand here and you're a little bit nervous, then there's a lot of adrenaline going on. And that can be mastered, but it's not easy. And I so the sculpture is spinning in the film, and it's I had this room, the Hans Vredeman de Vries room drawing. I had a walkthrough in that space as well in the film. And then I had this little almost Pokemon card that you could bring home with you, which is a proof of attendance certificate. So you have this little proof that you went through the understanding of the oxytocin process. And for those that were interested, this little code would unlock an NFT, a crypto art certificate, which is basically the same as a little physical one, just minted on the blockchain. And this afternoon at 4, I have my second little Pokemon card released in Copenhagen at my solo show at Martin Asbæk. That was a little commercial for my practice. It looks like this. Here's the code, so feel free to take up your phone and go to your camera, not your QR code reader, but your camera. And then maybe there are too many people in here, but try to see if you can find a floor. And people from all over the world sent me pictures where they used the sculpture in their environment, from beaches to skiing resorts. I had so many small films and photos sent to me, and it really made me so happy to see that it traveled all over the world. It became really this global open sculpture, and yeah, I'm interested in how these blockchain technologies can democratize art and not just be like the apes and the punks that you saw in the beginning, this digital asset as a commodity. I understand that also on a conceptual level, and I think it's interesting, but I also see so many artists that have deeper projects to offer to the world, and many of us are willing to also share it with the world. Here are some more, and here is the code again. That's it.